Boom Shakalaka, the largest exchange outflows of Ethereum ever, paired with the triple halving of EIP 1559, could send Ethereum up 1,000x, and that's not even unreasonable. Stay tuned. What's up, everyone? Randall here from Crypto Love. Today's video, we are talking about Ethereum, why the largest exchange outflows ever, paired with EIP 1559, could let Ethereum pump 1,000x, not 1,000%, 1,000x, and why that's not even unreasonable. Before we get into it, guys, make sure to like, subscribe, click the notification bell. Also, come join us over on Twitter at the Crypto Love. And today's video is sponsored by gemguardian, so stay tuned till the end for a review of the project. Now, if we take a look at Ethereum today, we have this very, very exciting chart. But before we get into this, let's take a look at some other very important things. Because right now, a lot of people are talking about Bitcoin. As a matter of fact, Bitcoin has been above $10,000 for a whole year now. It was not long ago when we thought a $10,000 Bitcoin was unicorn territory. You know, unicorn territory. Well, it turns out it's been above $10,000 for a whole year, and everybody's looking right now at $100,000. But we see some large investors going from all Bitcoin to potentially splitting up to Bitcoin and Ether. ARK Invest has decided to split to 60% Bitcoin, 40% ETH, as confidence in ETH grows dramatically. Not only ARK Invest, but we also have very large traders like Peter Brandt, like Raoul Paul, talking about Ethereum, very supportive of Ethereum. Peter Brandt here says, Litecoin, looking like a cup and handle formation, potentially could rocket upwards. Raoul Paul says ETH looks like a cup and handle too. Thoughts? And if we take a look at the ETH chart right now, it does look like a cup and handle. Now, if we zoom in right here, I'll draw this for you just so you can see cup and handle. Here's the cup. Here's a little handle. And then once it hits there, generally rockets upwards. Very bullish pattern. But other things that we can take a look at here, we have these rainbow spider lines. Now, I've made rainbow spider lines on Bitcoin as well, but this is the ETH USD chart. And we can see that Ethereum has actually broken above this yellow line, which goes through the fulcrum right there, all the way down to this price level right here. Well, broke and found support on there. The next line, well, it's going to break past previous all-time highs right around $4,200, and then likely up to this green spider line right around $6,000 to $7,000. Before potentially continuing up even higher to the blue spider line right around $18,000. And you're like, how is that even possible? Well, we're going to explain. Because right now, the largest outflow of Ethereum from centralized exchanges just happened. That's this chart here. If you can see right behind my head here, this is the largest, $1.24 billion of Ethereum taken off of centralized exchanges. Now, previously, when we had the next largest one, look at what happened to the price. Rocketed up. Well, how about the one before that? Price rocketed up. What do you think is going to happen to the price now? Price rocketed up. Last time it happened, as a matter of fact, Ethereum price increased by 60% within 30 days. Now, we have all of that happening. People are like, but Ethereum, it's really expensive to use and it's slow. You can't do 400 billion transactions at once. And guys, I mean, this is proof in pudding that Ethereum is worth its salt. So earlier this week, we had Solana and Arbitrum knocked offline while Ethereum evades attack. And that is true. They had a DDoS attack, which is pretty much like the most basic type of attack to protect against. Took down Solana, took down Arbitrum, but Ethereum got attacked unsuccessfully. Out of all of them, it's the one that stayed. Now, all that being said, what do we have to look out for Ethereum? Well, Croissant ETH here on Twitter says there's several things leading up to an extraordinary supply shock for Ethereum. It's getting to the point where it doesn't even matter who sells. There's simply too much demand for block space on Ethereum. Let's discuss. Well, let's discuss. All right. So in order to understand the extent of what's to come, you'll have to first take a look at the figures coming out of EIP 1559. Implemented in early August, the upgrade introduced a base fee burnt that varies based on network congestion per block. So, pretty much, this is how it was. In olden days, basically, fees, block reward went to the miners. Now, out of all transactions, there's a base fee that's burned, and then miners get the tip and the block reward. All right? So, that changes everything because now Ethereum is becoming deflationary. Not only that, but if we take a look at just what's happened over the past few months, since August, this is a few months. So, we have already 287,000 ETH burned. Rewards, 530,000 ETH. But if we take a look, the net reduction is 54%. That is enormous. Hyperdeflationary. You know all these shitcoins coming out talking about being hyperdeflationary. Look at Ethereum, the second largest coin, likely to become the first largest coin in the near future because before EIP 1559, Bitcoin had scarcity, Ethereum had network effect. Now, Ethereum has scarcity and network effect. So, potentially could replace Ethereum. And you see, he said previously, you don't price in an immediate supply shock to Ethereum with fluctuating burns. Now, guys, you have to remember, EIP 1559 is a triple halving. Three halvings happening at once. And just to give you an idea what that actually looks like, Bitcoin before three halvings was back here, $10. It's already 1,000x'd from there, three halvings. Well, that's what Ethereum could potentially do with three halvings. Now, not only that, but all of this ETH burned represents what would have gone into the hands of miners previously. Miners who were famously known for selling to cover expenses from energy-intensive proof of work. Soon, it won't be able to happen anymore. If we take a look at this chart on a bigger scale, you can see that actually the balance in miners' wallets has kind of plateaued right there. Now, we go on further to say that things like staking, EIP 1559 would make ETH deflationary. Just wait till proof of stake next year. There's already 7.6 million ETH staked in the deposit contract, or $25 billion worth of yield. But when that has been taken out of supply in less than a year, the issuance says to decrease even more because they don't even take into account the merge, which will significantly increase the yield for staking. When that happens, potentially the APY for stakers on ETH will shoot up significantly. And that gets even more interesting when we take a look at the validator queue, because you can't become a validator immediately. It actually takes time. Right now it takes about a week to be activated. Now, what happens then? Basically, we have a whole bunch of things. So his point is that he believes EIP 1559 staking in the merge will contribute to a supply shock never before seen on ETH. There's also factors like 27% of ETH locked up in smart contracts, $85 billion in DeFi, pretty much all NFT projects on Ethereum, stablecoins growing more than $60 billion per year. All of this affects Ethereum. If you take a look at it, all DeFi is on Ethereum. All NFTs are on Ethereum. And if we take a look at this burn, I mean, look at all of this. All of this being burned on Ethereum, all the NFTs on OpenSea, all the DeFi on Uniswap, all MetaMask, all of this burning Ethereum. And what's going to happen is Ethereum is going to get a point where the price just pops. And it goes up not to the green line, not to the blue line, not even to the purple line, but it just goes up dramatically. Because there's this article here, and Arthur Hayes wrote this before Ethereum EIP 1559 was even talked about. But in this article here, he says, let's take a look at Ethereum and let's see what happens if a lot of the money of the world from the banks actually comes into Ethereum. He says that let's assume that Ethereum can capture some of the percentage of the five-year earnings of banks and the big four audit firms. Okay? So, guess what? If it captures 0.1%, not 1%, 0.1%, that would be a $4,000 ETH. So that's pretty close to where we are right now. I was saying earlier, we could potentially see ETH 1,000x. Yeah, because guess what? That would put it up at 100%. Now, that's kind of ridiculous, but let's say 100x. Certainly reasonable, considering that's 10% of the value from the big four audit firms. So all of that, paired with the huge outflows, paired with the bullish charts, paired with all of DeFi and all of the reasons we're talking about here, Ethereum is poised to blow up right now. Like, blow up. Like, put everything else behind it, blow up, and go sky high. And potentially, you stake your Ethereum. You could be set for life, staking, like, next to no Ethereum, because you just earn passive income from it. So, that is why I am super excited for Ethereum. When I saw this today, I was like, holy cow, this is going to catapult Ethereum to levels we have not even seen. Take a look at the last couple times that Ethereum price had major outflows. The price rocketed up. We could see a rocketing up of Ethereum price in the very, very near future. So that brings us to the sponsored portion of this episode from GemGuardian at gemguardian.io. You can go check out their website. Unfortunately, I can't record the website and the video at the same time. It's too resource intensive for my computer. So we will go through this white paper right here. Now, GemGuardians, revolutionary NFT-based game running on Binance Smart Chain Network and developed by GemGuardians Games developed team based in the Philippines. The core of the game revolves around guardians battling each other to acquire aura and leveling up the guardian and increase XP, attack, and defense to level up the dragons. The progression of both guardian and dragon will increase chances of player to obtain more GPay rewards. Now, the vision of this project, GemGuardian's development team's vision is to establish a true play-to-earn ecosystem to facilitate blockchain development and evolve the DeFi industry fundamentals to make staking and earning more fun. In terms of tokens, they have the GemG token. The GemG is a governance token utility, includes governance rights, staking, and payment for loot box. There's also the GPay token, which is equivalent to cash or medium exchange in an economy. Utility includes game rewards and payment for loot box. In terms of the game economy, they have game income versus outflow, income from loot box, marketplace fees, and transactional fees, outflow from game rewards and staking pool. It's a double token economy with GemG tokens that will have positive income streams and price appreciation from constant loot box purchases, while GPay tokens will assume the selling pressure by acting as cash in the economy. The game reserve allocation of GemG tokens will constantly replenish with the liquidity of GPay tokens. They also have loot boxes, so multiple levels of loot box structure where higher levels will cost exponentially more than the previous. This brings a major inflow of income into the economy because it's the only way to increase potential income when playing the game. And you can see the loot boxes here, the increase in GPay tokens for them, and also the percent of rare chances. Now, the game economy also has staking pools, so high APR staking pools for GemG and GPay tokens will decrease circulating supply and outflow of rewards. And this works with GemG and GPay staking rewards with token rewards, GemG and GPay staking with NFT rewards, NFT staking for token rewards, APR of the staking pools. Also, at low initial market cap, right now at $210,000, potentially could have huge demand as there will be little supply in the market. Projected income inflow versus rewards outflow from loot box sales, 2% of transactions, 8% of all marketplace transactions, and 15% from auction NFTs, outflow, staking rewards, and game rewards. Now, in terms of gameplay, they have obtaining loot box, guardian and dragon requirement, battle, rewards, withdrawing GPay, or staking GPay. In terms of the game economy, they also have a marketplace to offer a chance to buy and sell their guardians and dragons. All NFTs are categorized as guardian, dragon, element, and rarity, and you can go on the website to check out the marketplace. Unfortunately, like I said, it's just too resource intensive for my computer to be able to show that stuff. And then tokenomics. So we have tokenomics right here. Seed sales, public sales, private sales, team, game reserves, all of that right here, and seed sales as well. And then taking a look at them compared with the competitors. So we have GemGuardian here. They compare GemGuardian. They compare themselves to Axie Infinity, Crypto Blades, Step Hero, Star Atlas. In terms of NFT staking, only they have that with Step Hero. In terms of staking, only they have that with Crypto Blades. Marketplace, them, Axie Infinity, and Step Hero, and Star Atlas. But you can see down here on the bottom, in terms of ROI, if they were to get to each of these games, there would be 50x to Step Hero, 116x to Star Atlas, 266x to Crypto Blades, or 600x to Axie Infinity. You can see here a lot of partners and integrations, and then the whitelist dates here for Binstarter, Trustpad, and pools. And that is pretty much it for GemGuardian. Now, also, there is a link down in the pinned comment. They have a public sale IDO whitelist competition. So that is now live. Anyone who wants to can participate in the IDO. And you can go click on the link and fill out the information there. So thank you very much to Gem Guardian for sponsoring the episode. And I will catch you guys later. Peace.